Good morning again. Turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians 1, that's where we're going to spend almost all of our time this morning. There's so much there. We have been going through Ephesians as a staff for much of the fall and this series called Rooted and Grounded. And as we are coming out of Titus and wanting to make sure that we're teaching doctrine, that we are making sure that we're setting a solid foundation, there's no other book that is as concise and as intentional about setting that foundation. The book of Ephesians is set up really in two fairly clear halves. If you haven't been in it in a while, the first three chapters are really all of these pouring outs, all of these teachings about what it is that we have in Christ and what God has accomplished from eternity past and what he has promised for eternity future. And he just goes through and he just pours out these deep truths. In fact, so deep that a couple times within those first three chapters, Paul comes to the end of one of these long sentences and one of these long teachings in Ephesians, and he just says, I have to pray. He just goes into prayer, praying for the readers of which we are today. And then in chapter 4, it gets very much into our business. It gets very much into the meddling of the day-to-day of how to treat your kids. And kids, how to treat your parents. And husbands, how to treat your wives. And wives, how to treat your kids. And employers, how to treat your employees. And employees, how you work for your employers. It gets very, very into your life. That's the way theology should work. That's the way God's word should work. We should go into the doctrine. We should go into the theology. And then it should come out in the way that we live. Rooted and grounded, that theology, the truth about God, should be what we are deeply rooted in. Understanding God and ourselves and others. Rooted deeply, and then growing out of that, we are able to then produce fruit. We're then able to live in the day in and day out challenges of life and the temptations that come. When we're not deeply rooted in who God is and why we're here, we very quickly understand the weakness and the lack of our ability to produce fruit. Why do I get so frustrated? Why do I get so fearful? Why do I cling so much to my money? I know that that's not what I'm supposed to be doing. And so Ephesians is very intentional in having us to be able to be rooted and grounded. Now, specifically in Ephesians chapter 1, what we're doing is we are coming out of one long sentence in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. It's just one long thought that Paul is just pouring out. And then we're going to start our text in verse 15. So if you have your Bibles open, I want to reread verses 15 through 19. Just the first half of the prayer, it's more than enough for us to chew on today. It's more than enough for us to be able to think through this week. And then next week, we're actually going to take a break and we're going to get into an Advent study. How is it that Christ is our hope and our peace and our joy and our love as we prepare for Christmas? And then after the Christmas celebrations, we're going to come back to the second half of Paul's prayer. So just so you know where we're going to go, we're going to take the first half of this prayer. There's plenty there for us today. And then we're going to take a deep breath and we are going to focus on the Lord Jesus Christ until Christmas comes. And then we'll jump back into Ephesians, and what we're going to see is there is this prayer that Paul gives us at the end of Ephesians 1 that is just all about the power and the ability that we have to go into the world because we are in Christ. And I think that's going to be a great way to start 2020. And so you guys can be reading through that, thinking through that, but we're going to be in Ephesians today, and then right at the beginning of the year, we'll be preaching through the rest of that prayer. So, simple outline, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 19, we see that Paul prays. In verses 15 and 16, he tells us why he prays. And this is why he prays. This is the big idea. He prays that we would know more. That is, we know more, and that's what really that first three chapters in Ephesians is about, just knowing those things, that then we would be able to produce fruit. We would be able to respond both emotionally and in our lives in ways that glorify God. So he prays first that we would know the Father, we would know the giver, and then second, that we would know the gifts. And as we do that, we can be greatly affected even over this Thanksgiving season. I'm going to read again Ephesians chapter 15. Be looking for that outline. Be seeing how Paul prays, and then he prays that we would know the Father, and then he prays that we would know what is the hope and what is the gifts that we have. Let's pray together, and then I'll read the text. Father, I thank you for this moment. I pray that you would calm my heart. I pray that you would help me to just speak your words in a text that is so encouraging and so timely for many of us who are in the room. And Father, I pray that we would bring our troubles, we would bring our concerns and our doubts, and we would lay them on your word, and we would see how you would respond. For Father, you know how weak we are and how much we need your word, and I pray you would feed us with it today. In Jesus' name. And so let us read the word of the Lord. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might. So the first point is that we see that Paul prays. Verse 15, he says, for this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. So we see that Paul prays for us. He prays for the readers of the scripture. The Holy Spirit guides Paul into revealing these things. And as he is overcome, as he is writing these down, or as he is dictating these, he breaks into this praise and he says, for this reason. What's the reason? He says, for this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus. For this reason, as we read this, this is one long sentence. So he comes out of one long sentence in 3 to 14. Now he's in another long sentence, but he says, for this reason, and he's pointing back to 3 through 14. And it's kind of a hinge. So that for this reason is a hinge between 3 to 14 and then 15 through the rest of the chapter. So let's look back up into 3 to 14. I'll show you kind of what I mean. For this reason, he sees what God has been doing in eternity, what he's presently doing, what he's promising in the future. In verse 3, we see of Ephesians, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We see that phrase farther down in the prayer. For this reason, because we have received every spiritual blessing in Christ, in verse 3. Verse 4, the fact that God has chosen them in Christ before the foundations of the world. And verse 5, the fact that they were predestined for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ. In verse 7, that they have gained redemption through the blood of Christ. Verse 7 again, that they have forgiveness of their trespasses. Verse 9, the mystery of God's will has been made known. Verse 11, they have obtained an inheritance according to the purpose of Him. In verse 13, they heard the truth and they believed. In verse 13 again, they were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of that inheritance. We see that word in the prayer, of that inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of His glory. And so there is a lot to be thankful for. And Paul says, for this reason, he prays. So Paul is praying because he sees all of these truths of God. But it's not only that. He sees that it's taken effect. He sees that all of those truths of God, all of those blessings in Christ, all of those decisions he made, that sealing of the Holy Spirit, he pivots, he hinges, and he says, because of this, I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. So, for this reason, what is the reason? The reason is this. Paul sees in the believers in Ephesus the evidence of God's working in their life. And he says, that's encouraging to me. I'm thankful for that. I see the fruit that has come out of what God is doing in your life. And so because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you. So we glorify God, we bless God, but it's okay to be thankful for people. It's terrific to be able to see the people in your life who you see the power of God working in. I don't know about you, but that is one of the most encouraging things for me. I am genuinely thankful for my brother Kevin. Genuinely. And I am so thankful for him as I walk in and I'm in this text, which is the book of Ephesians is just amazing. It just preaches itself. I just want to get out of the way. I don't want to distract from what the text is saying. And Kevin just gives me a word from the Lord. And it just calms me. Who's in your life that you're thankful for? Who is it that you can go to, who you can depend on to give you a fitly spoken word? And you know the Lord is working in their life. Do you have someone like that? If you do, it would be great to tell them. We're in a Thanksgiving season, right? So I think this is simple. Give thanks. Maybe right now. I don't mind if you text. Right now. Maybe you were just to text somebody and say, you know what? Pastor Brandon just said that there's someone in his life that he's thankful for. He sees the fruit of God's working in this person's life. And I don't want to forget to tell you that. Maybe I don't say it enough. Parents, maybe it's your kids. Maybe we get so distracted and so caught up in what they don't do right that we don't genuinely tell them enough that we're thankful for the Lord's working in their life. Maybe it's your husbands. Maybe it's your wives, your fiancés, your siblings. I don't know who that is. But I know that the Lord works through people. And as many people are in this room, somebody was worked through with another person, through another person. And it's good to give them thanks. Because you see the fruit of what God has been doing. And so he remembers them in prayer. These things drive Paul to pray. But what is the mark that he is thankful for? Look back at the text. He says, "Because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you." So, I am thankful because I see these marks in my brother. We're thankful because there are certain marks that, as a Christian, that are there and evidencing the work of God. One of those is that we have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, or the Lord Jesus, as it says here, and your love toward all the saints. Now, we could just camp here for the rest of our time, but we'll walk through it fairly quickly. But the first mark is that there is faith in the Lord Jesus. There's faith in the Lord Jesus. It's not in, I believe in God. It's not in, I like to do really, really good things and help people. It's not that I go to church. It's that there is evidence that their faith is exclusively in God. Faith in Christ alone, by grace alone, informed by the scriptures alone. That is the mark of someone that Paul is saying, "I'm thankful for. I've seen the faith you have in Christ." Let's look up in Ephesians chapter 3 through 14 if you have it. I'm going to show you how important this concept is in the book of Ephesians. Just 3 through 14, we'll just kind of flip through. You don't get the head start that I get to draw in my Bible and to connect things. So I'll try to go slowly. But verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ." You guys see that? In Christ. Verse 4, "Even as he chose us in him before the foundations of the world." Verse 5, "He predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ." Verse 6, "With which he has blessed us in the beloved." If it's an ESV, that's capitalized, that is Christ. Verse 7, "In him we have redemption." Verse 9, "According to the purpose which he set forth in Christ." Verse 10, "To unite all things in him," that is in Christ. Verse 11, "In him we have obtained an inheritance." Verse 12, "So that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory." In him. Verse 13 again, "The gospel of your salvation and believed in him." And then in verse 15, "For this very reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus." The first mark of someone who Paul is thankful for, and who we can, and we can be thankful for anybody who helps or for any good thing that comes from God's common grace. But what we're talking about here is that there is this clear and exclusive devotion and faith in Christ. It's not in other things. And we can say that a lot. But then Paul puts this disclaimer, this evidentiary statement, and this is the other thing that he's heard of, your love toward all the saints. So, as A.W. Pink and many, many others, and I'm sure that you have heard this before, but saving faith in Christ and spiritual love for all whom he loves are inseparably connected. Inseparably connected. We can see this in so many ways. The book of 1 John would say that if you say that you love God who you can't see, but you hate your brother who you can see, then the truth is not in you. In fact, it's the evidence of that saving faith in Christ that we have love for one another. In fact, Jesus would say, this is how that they will know that you are of mine, of me. It is that you would love one another. In his high priestly prayer, he prays to the Father that they would be unified, we would be unified, so that they would believe in him. And so we see that these two are inseparable. As we come together as a body of believers, and we are just being poured into by the Spirit, we're being poured into by this truth of what has happened to us who know Christ, it should cause us to be more patient with those who are around us. That's part of that evidence that Paul sees. Now, if we want to see maybe what he's talking about, you're saying maybe put some meat on it, just turn over maybe one page to Ephesians 4. Remember, Ephesians 1, 2, and 3 are all just this pouring in of truth. Ephesians 4, then, is the acting out of it. What does that look like in real life? Like the meddling, like the marriage, and like the kids, and all of that. And we'll just go to Ephesians 4. It just starts right out there. It says, I therefore, this is Paul, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called. We're going to talk more about the calling as one of those gifts. So, same word. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So if you're just kind of making a list saying, okay, what's Pastor Brandon saying that I need to be doing to be loving toward all the saints, you can go to Ephesians 4 and there's a starter list. That would be how that manifests itself. And so you may be able to look at your life and say, okay, I have this in place, but I don't see this. And so what I'm not doing is I'm not asking you to fix that thing. Like, that's not how the Christian life works. There are a lot of people who know how to act godly that are not knowing God. There are a lot of people who know a lot of facts about the Bible and know a lot of facts about God that are not knowing God. What I would challenge you to do today is to go back in and say, that is an evidence if I am not being humble, if I'm being proud, if I'm being harsh, if I'm being impatient, if I'm not bearing with one another, like I'm just saying, I don't want to be around that person, I don't want to talk to that person, or I'm bearing with one another in grief, not in love, I'm not eager to maintain the unity. In fact, I like kind of arguing about the things that go on in church, in politics, in family. I kind of like that. No comments, Drew. Okay, so what we see there is an indicator that we don't yet understand Christ's love. Not as fully as we could. And so I'm not asking you to fix the fruit. I'm asking you to look at the root. I'm asking you to look at this, 3 through 14, and allow that to sing in your heart and allow that to motivate you to live differently. But Paul says he sees that, and so he's thankful. There's nothing in this text that is condemning. There's nothing in this text that is offensive. It is just pouring out the grace of God and just saying, these are the things that you have. And in many ways, these are things that we see to a person. I know that we see this at Bethel Baptist Church. We see that kind of love. We see that kind of patience. We see that kind of bearing along with one another. We see that kind of unity in the faith. And that is all grace. And I'm thankful for so many of you that although we might not agree on everything, I know genuinely that you love me. And I pray that you genuinely know that I love you. As I was on campus yesterday doing some things, and we have a men's prayer meeting here every Saturday morning at 8 o'clock. And a couple of those men were in the parking lot, and I had this thought in my mind. I was glad I had caught them. And I said, how long have you been married? And so one of the men, over 40 years. Another one of the men, over 20 years. And I just asked this question. I said, do you love your wife more now than you did when you first got married? And they, just for the record, you guys know who you are, they said yes, they do. If I was to take a raise of hands, and I'm not going to, as I look out and I know so many of you, I assume that you would answer the same way. That you love your wife more now. And I also assume that the women, that the wives, would say, I love my husband more now than I ever have. Even after all of these years. And so I asked those men, why is that? How is that? One of the men said, because the longer I've been married, the more I've understood love. The more I've understood selflessness. As I look back on myself, I think about how selfish I was, and now it's just all for her. I just want to live for her. And the other one chimed in then and said, when I look at Christ and the church and our command to husbands to love their wives as Christ loves the church, he said, it just knocks me down every time. I can't even put a percent on it. I can't even say I'm 1% like that because of the love that Christ has for me. The thing that motivates us to love more is to know more. Not to know more facts, but to know the person. To go through things with the person, to have shared experience with the person, to see how that person responds to you, to see how you can pour into the other person. And that really is Paul's first request. Look back with me in verse 17. He says, I pray for you. I don't cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. Again, this is one long sentence. But he says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, so he's the object there, the God, the Father of glory, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, that he may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of him. That him is going back to God. He's giving the spirit of wisdom and of revelation. I like charts. I want to get out of the way of the text. I want you to be able to read the text, to understand it clearly. We see that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, that he may give you, this is Paul's prayer. He prays that God would give you these two things. And today, I pray that God would give you these two things. It is the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him and the eyes of the heart. Those are the two things that Paul is praying that would be given to you. Do you see how both of them are this call, this prayer for knowledge? There's a prayer that you would know more about the Father. And that's really what this entire text has been about. The entire first three chapters is getting to know the Father, getting to know the giver. I'm not going to take time to do that today. We'll do that through history, through going forward. But what you need to see is that getting to know God is done through the revealed word of God. You get to know God by reading the word of God. So many times I think we just read the word because that's the information that we need. But it really is the self-revelation of God himself. God is saying, I want you to know me so that you will love me, so that it will go well with you. To glorify God is the best thing for you. And so not only do you get to know God through the revealed word, but, and I know this may sound a little bit scary, but we'll talk about it. You get to know God through your lived experience with him. If a woman came to me this week and just said, Pastor Brandon, I just want to talk to you about this one of the older women in the church, and she said, God just showed me something this week, and I did not see it before. Have you ever been there? You're a Christian, you're walking. Paul isn't praying that the Spirit, right, that they would be saved, because they're already saved. They're in this. He sees this proof in them, but this is something that is called a perfect type of a word, a perfect present participle, if you want to know. And so that means it happened one time, and there's ongoing effects. That's what the Spirit is, and we have to know that it's God who's giving that so that we would continue to grow. And so this woman comes to me and says, Pastor Brandon, I just want to share this with you. And I was so upset with this person, and I was so angry when I would see them. And then God showed me that it was to show me. God showed me that it was to show me. Paul prays that we would continue to grow. Paul prays that we would continue because of the Spirit's illumination, the Spirit's help, that we would continue to see where we need to grow. It's not one and done with the life and godliness. It's a walk. Are you there yet? Are you at a place where you can see temptation in your life, where you can see frustration in your life, where you can see conflict in your life, and you can quickly go to God and say, God, thank you for showing me that about me? Are you still stuck on other people? Is it still other people and places and things that are the problem? Paul is praying that we would have the Spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of Him. He is a good God who cares for you and is through your suffering, through your struggling, making you more into the image of Christ. Young person, that temptation you're feeling right now, that thing you're struggling with right now, that thing that you know that you struggle with, I don't know, is Tim in here? In Bible class right now? Yeah. Man, that's grace. It's grace. It's grace to know that He will continue to work in you and perfect you. That's grace. Do you know that about God yet? That's what He wants you to know. Again, go back into the Word and see what God has done. And then finally, knowing the gifts. Knowing these gifts. That second gift that we are to be given is the enlightenment, or the eyes. They are the eyes, enlightenment. So go with me in verse 18. Having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which He has called you, what are the riches of His glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of His power toward us who believe. And so we see this. Paul is praying. He's seeing the evidence of 3 to 14. He's seeing that in the believer's life. And so now he's saying, I pray for you. I'm thankful for you. And so I'm going to pray for you for these two things. One, the continued Spirit, which has been given to you, that will give you revelation and will give you wisdom. That continued progressive sanctification. And then the other thing that I'm praying for is that you would have eyes that are enlightened, that you would know the hope. And so he prays for these eyes. This enlightened, again, it's something that happens at one time. It's a past action. It's an ongoing result. It really would be what we would see as a Christian worldview. Would we have eyes to see that? If we were to turn to Psalm 19:8, we won't for the sake of time, but Psalm 19:8 is a great place to start. It says, the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Psalm 119, 18, there's this prayer of the psalmist, open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. He's looking at the scripture, he's looking at the book, but Paul is praying that it would affect your heart, that it would go from your head to your heart, that it would be effective. Acts 26:18, there's this prayer to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among those sanctified by faith in me. This is from Christ. Acts 26:18. There is this enlightening of the eyes of the heart that Paul is praying for in the readers. Because there's a hope to be had. As we understand the world rightly, as we have those enlightened eyes, those eyes that are full of light, those eyes that understand the way that things are and the way that things work, we live differently. And Paul says, I want you to have the spirit of revelation and wisdom, and I want you to have the eyes that are enlightened that see the hope of your calling. The hope of our calling is something that is amazing. As we look at 3 through 14, he's really wanting to seal the deal with that. He wants them to know what is being affected upon them by God. He wants them to know what God is doing so that they will hope. So hope is a heart thing. Hope is a heart thing. It's not a head thing. It's something that you feel. And again, as others might know who might be in the senior Bible class, right? So there's a head system and a heart system. Which one wins? The heart system. And I'll say a statement and we can talk about this. The heart system wins every time. There's a head system and there's a heart system. There's a physical eyes. We read the words on the page. And there's a head system, and it causes us to hope, and it causes us to respond, and it causes us to obey. And every one of you in this room completely understand what I mean when you go to McDonald's. Like, McDonald's, on paper, is not really healthy food. But we all go there. Well, I go there. So, a little confession, right? And I take my kids there, too. But, it's not enough to know something on paper. It's not enough to know something in your head. We would all be at the gym far more than we are. We would all be more self-controlled than we are. We would all be more gentle than we are if it was just a head thing. Paul prays for their hearts to get it, not just their heads. Paul prays that they would see that head and heart system, and their hearts would be affected. Look with me at these last three points. We see that there is this hope to which we have been called. Verse 18, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. You've been chosen. You have been chosen to be holy and blameless. You have been brought in as sons. Romans 8:28-30 would be a great place to go as you are studying this out and just to see that there is this not only a hope, but a guarantee. I'm going to turn over there just for a minute if you want to turn to Romans 8. It just can't go without saying. We just don't obey these things. We just don't hear these things. It says this in verse 8:28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. Verse 30. And those whom he predestined, he also called. That same word. What is the hope of our calling? And those whom he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. And so if you are in the call, then you are in eternity already, seated in the heavenlies with Christ. Do you believe that? Do you live like that? Do you live with that confidence and that devotion to Christ because of that? But then he says this, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints? This is going back to verse 11 in Ephesians. He's just sealing the scripture with a prayer. We cling so much to our things. We try so hard to hold on to this life when we have a glorious and imperishable inheritance in heaven. Do you believe that? In your heart, does it affect you? Do you look forward to that? And then finally, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe? According to the working of his great might. I was at a conference just a couple weeks ago, and I heard a preacher, not talking about this text, but saying, so often we as Christians, we read the Bible as if it's a menu at a restaurant. And so let's just picture, we're here, we all pull out our menus, and we say, oh, hope. Riches of the glorious inheritance in the saints. Sounds good. What is the immeasurable greatness of his power? Power? I could go for some power right now. And then we do this. We put our Bible down, and we walk out of the restaurant hungry. We don't partake. We don't taste. We don't engage. Bethel Baptist Church, you're being offered this. God, through his Holy Spirit, through grace bringing you in today, he is offering you the understanding of the great power that he is working through the Holy Spirit, the great inheritance that you have waiting for you, the hope that is your calling. Will you take your menu and just put it down? Or will you engage? Will you meditate on those words? Have your eyes been opened to something new today? So how will we then live with that? A couple years ago, I was on a vacation, and we got the opportunity to drive race cars. And I like driving race cars. Sometimes it's my minivan, but this is on a track, and this was something that was just a special opportunity. And so we kind of watch the people kind of drive around, and so it's my turn, and I buckle in, I put the 5-point harness on, I'm driving the track. It's exhilarating, it's amazing. Now, honestly, I would never drive my minivan the way I drove that race car. Why? My wife's in here, so I wouldn't tell you even if I did. But the part of the reason is because I don't feel secure. I don't know what kind of power I have. I don't know what kind of abilities I have. I don't know how safe I'll be if something happens. So I buckle into the race car, and not only do I buckle in the race car, so I'm feeling pretty secure now. Not only does this car have, 30-inch wide tires and is super low to the ground and has more horsepower than it needs. Not only that, but now I have a co-pilot. And he's going to talk through my helmet through a microphone and tell me when to brake, when to turn, when to accelerate, when to stop, when to go. And now I have not only the power, but I have the person. And now I get the green flag. And I drive one whole lap as fast as I can. It's terrific. And I drive that lap, and I come by the start finish line, and I'm waving, and I'm just enjoying this, and I'm shifting gears. And I hear in my headset, brake, 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 brake. And I end up in the rocks. I spin out, and I end up in the rocks. And I'm like, yes, that was awesome. That was terrific. Why was I not afraid? Because of the power, the security, the purpose, and the person. Bethel Baptist Church, and even myself included in that, we drive like we're all in minivans. in our spiritual life. We drive like we're all in minivans in our discipleship and evangelistic life. We have been given such power and such purpose and such a person in the Holy Spirit that you do not need to be afraid. Drive your life in Christ like a race car. Drive your life in Christ like it's a race car. Listen to the person next to you, unlike me. Listen to the person. Trust the power. Trust the purpose. Let's pray together, and then we'll close. Father, I thank you for the time that you give us to be in your word. And God, I pray that this word would reach the hearts of the hearers. And Father, I pray that this word would produce fruit. I pray that we would be different because of this day, because of the truth that we have sung, because of the truth that we have heard. And Father, because of the Spirit in us, awakening us, opening our eyes as we are on the path to become more like Christ. I thank you for the visitors, for the guests, for those who are longtime members. Father, I pray that our fellowship after the service would be sweet. In Jesus' name, amen.